Is this the voice? Oh, it is the voice of God. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Albert Galatin, Abraham Alphonse Albert Galatin. I was born in Geneva, in 1761 and arrived to the United States in 1780 as a 19-year-old. It is my immense pleasure, and I forgot to do something absolutely necessary. Your Excellency, Mr. Ambassador, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for being here today. It is my great honor and privilege to speak to you, to make brief remarks before we begin our discussion here today. We are here in celebration of the Constitution of the Swiss Confederation's ratification. And it is appropriate that we be here in the Constitution Center, which honors the United States Constitution, for such a discussion. I will not make very much of what it is that is comparable between the two. I will leave that to the distinguished panelists who are here before me. But I will make a thought available to you. I am often asked when I speak to others whether I am a friend of order or a friend of liberty. And why my answer is, if you have too much order and an insufficiency of liberty, you tend towards tyranny. If you have too much liberty and an insufficiency of order, you tend towards anarchy. Neither of those forms of governance is fit for a free people. Now, my view of the Swiss Constitution in comparison to the American Constitution is that the Swiss, very much like clockwork, have very, very exacting and very precise directions, whereas the American Constitution is rather looser in its form. In my view, I may find that there is disagreement from the panel, but this is my understanding of it. Nonetheless, what both constitutions have is the assurance of individual rights in comparison to the states, in the case of America, or the cantons, in the case of Switzerland, and the federal authority in both instances. And it is the business of all to assure that those rights are exercised responsibly, that people accept the responsibilities attendant to the exercise of those rights. And with that in mind, I thank you for your presence here today, and I will pass this on to His Excellency. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Honorable Galatin. It's always exciting to take a trip back in time, but let us come back to the reality, or back to the future, like a famous American movie says. Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends of Switzerland, dear friends of the US, it's a pleasure welcoming you, having you here, and a special warm welcome to our panelists today, to Professor Brendan O'Leary, to Professor Tina Kempin-Reuter, and to Fabian Fellmann, our correspondent from Tamedia, who came from Washington, as well as, of course, to the moderator, Laureen Swartz, President and CEO of the World Affairs Council of Philadelphia. Ladies and gentlemen, 1848 marks a very special point in the development of the history of Europe and its drive towards democracy. 1848 sees the protests and the barricades in Berlin, in Paris, and it leads to revolutions that in the end fail and are succeeded by the oppression of the liberal, the republican, and the socialist movements throughout Europe. But when we look at Switzerland at that time, the story turns out completely differently. On the September 12th in 1848, the state, the old Swiss Confederacy, becomes a federal state and the first republic in Europe. Switzerland becomes the avant-garde of democratic development in Europe at that time. And today I'm very happy that we're all here united together to celebrate the 175th anniversary of the Swiss Constitution. As you know, I have arrived only a it's exactly a year to a year and a week ago to the US. So, and working out of New York, one of my first trip, how could it be differently? Of course, had to be to Philadelphia, the cradle of the modern US, the former capital. And when I came to visit our honorary consul, Christine, thank you very much for organizing. Before I forget it, without you, this could not have been possible. When I came to Philadelphia, I found here the perfect place to organize today's event here at the National Constitution Center. Because I learned that in 2006, for the first time, our Bundesbrief, our charter, left Switzerland. It was only so far one time that it left Switzerland, and I was told that the minister came with a lower security detail than the Bundesbrief, no? And I'm very happy to see here today people who were engaged in that transport and receiving the Bundesbrief and organizing it with their association from the Bundesbrief Association here, that you are back here. It's a special pleasure. So I thought this is the natural place where we should discuss today our 175th anniversary of the Constitution. But what does the Constitution mean to us? What does it mean to you? Every person has a relation to the Constitution. If you're a Spaniard, you might have a different approach to your Constitution than when you're a Swiss. So I was thinking, what is my relation to the Constitution? What is it for me as a citizen, and what is it for me as a diplomat when I speak about Switzerland? And I believe the first point is that our constitution is closely linked to direct democracy. It is not just a holy paper that cannot be touched and changed. No, it can be changed, it can be amended, thanks to direct democracy. And that provides this close linkage between citizens of Switzerland and is part of the civic engagement of the Swiss people. It is enough to collect enough signatures, and you can ask for the amendment of our constitution, which is rather unique. Another point which is very close to my heart is the principle of subsidiarity. The spirit of Switzerland is found in this principle. It says, whatever you can do and decide close to the citizen on a lower level, do it. Only things that have to be in the competence of the federal state should be done by the federal state. And the best example is how we build roads. Municipal roads are decided by whom? By the municipality. Regional roads from one city to the others are decided by the cantonal authorities. And only the national roads connecting different provinces are done by the federal state. There is a third element. I think that's the element we get with the breast milk or the cow milk, which is part of our DNA. It's the constant strive for consensus. The consensus seeking, consensus building is another very key element, I believe, of our Swiss democratic system. And it provides the stability that you mentioned, because seeking not a simple majority, but including all stakeholders, provides these long-lasting decisions where people know they are integrated in the process, and even if once you might lose against the majority, you have been part of the process, and you might be the winner of the next time. And it has also a very good influence on our politicians, because they all know that we have still the popular referendum. Your laws have to be so good that no one is going to collect 50,000 signatures and ask for a referendum. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't want to give here classes of diplomat on the Swiss Constitution, because today we have the real experts here. So I believe an ambassador also should know when not to talk. And I think I have reached my time. I will finish here. But again, I'm very happy to welcome you all here, you Swiss citizens, the friends of the US and of Switzerland. Again, a thank you to our panelists, to the moderator, to the organizer, Christine, to the second Christine from my team, and to my team, Joachim and Donovan. Thank you for organizing, thank you for attending, and I hand over to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador, and to all of our guests here today. You know, when you get invited to moderate a panel, the first question is, well, who else will be on this group? And I can tell you that when we had the prep call, we had so much fun, and we had to stop ourselves. We actually Zoom cut us off, and we wanted to keep going. I guarantee you there is such a wealth of knowledge among my colleagues here today and different perspectives about the similarities and differences between these two constitutions and these two places and peoples today. Our conversation will be relatively straightforward. We will have a moderated discussion for a period of time, and then, of course, we'll make the opportunity for you all to ask your questions. So we look forward to hearing from you towards the end of our conversation as well. I'd like to briefly introduce our panelists and give you a few details on their backgrounds as well. On my far left, we have Dr. Brendan O'Leary. He's the Lauder Professor of Political Science at the University of Pennsylvania, right here in Philadelphia. He also is an honorary member of the Royal Irish Academy and an honorary professor of political science at Queen's University in Belfast. He has authored too many books and articles to mention here, but is quite an accomplished thinker and author and professor. He has also been an advisor to the European Union, to the United Nations, and many countries around the world on politics and governance and more. In the center, we have Dr. Tina Kempen-Reuter. She is an associate professor at the University of Alabama down in Birmingham. So thank you for joining us here in Philadelphia, Tina. She is the director of the Institute for Human Rights and Social Science and Justice Research. As you can hear, her work focuses largely on human rights. She is Swiss by birth and background and has a really deep understanding of this country and her home country. And last but certainly not least, Mr. Fabian Feldman. He is the U.S. political correspondent for the Swiss media company, TA Media. He has an extensive career in journalism in Switzerland and now is a U.S. political correspondent. He has a focus on politics and government and a fresh perspective to share with us today. I'd like to start our conversation by framing some of the foundational ideas with which the ambassador shared with us, and I'd like to expand upon those. Tina, can we start with you? Could you just offer us a brief perspective on how did Switzerland and Swiss thinkers and philosophers influence the U.S. Constitution of 1787?
Yes, well, first of all, let me thank everyone for inviting me. I probably came the farthest, I assume. So I appreciate this invitation, and I'm very honored to be a part of this panel. With regards to the question, I would say the greatest impact was actually in the pre-constitution period, so during the time of the Revolutionary War or pre-revolution period. And I would say there's sort of three areas. The first one is ideology and philosophy. So natural law scholars from Switzerland, especially Jean-Jacques Burlamaqui from Geneva and Émeric de Vatel, originally from Neuchâtel, were really influenced, or they influenced U.S. thinking during the Revolutionary War. You probably know that natural law is the idea that humans have the ability to reason, and that this is given by nature, including certain rights that are inalienable and universal, like the idea behind human rights and so on. So they were natural law scholars that were influenced during the Age of Enlightenment and influenced the major documents like the U.S. Declaration of Independence and also the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Now, those two philosophers you probably have never heard of. When we talk about natural law, we think of Hobbes, we think of Locke, we think of other scholars. But the fact is that they were actually read by Americans at the time. And especially Burlamaqui was influential because he's said to be the first person to see the quest for happiness as a natural right. And as you know, this was included in the Declaration of Independence. The Swiss also, or Swiss thinking also influenced this question of what should the United States look like if in a time where, you know, there were discussions around what independence from Britain. And so Swiss thought was really used to kind of counter ideas to create a strong relationship with Britain and maybe a more centralized country. The second way is Swiss history. So there were a number of books that came out in the early 1700s that really talked about the Swiss history, independence from the great powers of Europe, and then also the Swiss military system, and that had an influence on the U.S. Constitution. Finally, the constitutional model, right? The original Constitution of the United States from 1777. The Articles of Confederation were closely. The Swiss Constitution and the Swiss model, at the time really served as a role model. So principles like what you mentioned before, like deferred sovereignty, state power, and those kinds of things were really important. And fact is, at the time, the two countries, well, I wouldn't call them necessarily countries, but Switzerland and the U.S. looked very similar. They had 13 units. They were both confederal systems, and there were pretty much no other examples to look to throughout Europe, because most of Europe at the time was using monarchic systems. Now, with regards to the 1787 Constitution, which we know that the Confederation ultimately failed, and James Madison especially was opposed to the Confederation because he said, well, they're weak towards the inside because they do not have a central power, and they're also weak towards the outside because they tend to be more easily dissolution is a big problem. They might end easily. So in the end, I would say the Swiss influence wasn't as great as it was early on. I would say only two provisions kind of remained that influenced the U.S. Constitution. One is the Second Amendment and the right to bear arms, and the 10th Amendment, which clarifies that the central government only has the powers given by the Constitution, and all other rights and duties should remain with the state. So Swiss influence during the time of the Constitution is really kind of limited to the anti-federalists that were standing for these kinds of topics.
Thank you, Tina. And Fabian, let's take the inverse of that question. How much of the United States can we find in the Swiss Federal Constitution of 1848? What are the highlights?
Well, quite a lot. Switzerland was confronted with a major problem after civil war, needing to overcome internal divisions and mistrusts between the cantons, looking for a common system of government, and where would they find an example? I think the United States was certainly one of the inspirations at the time, one of the interesting political experiments at the time that anyone politically interested would be watching in the days, particularly someone trying to draft a new constitution. But there was also a second big influence, of course, which was the French occupation period in Switzerland in the early 18th century. So where the Swiss lived a modern state and government. Now, the Tina already mentioned the sovereignty of the cantons that remained in the Swiss Constitution then of 1848, which was something that the United States had the same. So it's the very structure of the federal state and of the federal government and of the relations with the states and the cantons that is exactly the same. We find that in the Swiss Constitution of 1848, the first three articles are actually concepts that we find in the Constitution of the United States as well. So that's the description of the Union, then the finality of the Union, defense towards the outside, law and order towards the inside, protection of freedoms of the citizens, development of the Commonwealth. And then third and very important, as Tina had mentioned before, that the sovereignty stays with Canton. And then from that on, we go to the structure of the federal government. We have the bicameral system that the Swiss took from the United States. We have two chambers, the Senate and the House of Representatives, the Senate in Switzerland and the National Council, respectively, that both have to approve any amendment of law so that it may be effective. And then we also see that the Bill of Rights in the United States Constitution in the amended later on was copied by the Swiss. We have the equality before the law, we have the freedom of religion, freedom of the press, freedom of assembly. But then we still see some Swiss idiosyncrasies, for example, the ban of the Jesuit order. That's something that we wouldn't have found in the US Constitution.
A few surprises in there. We know these influences, these reciprocal influences, certainly did not stop at the writing of our respective constitutions. National events, political movements, history has shaped one nation back and forth with the other. Brendan, can you share with us some additional perspective on this? Perhaps we could touch base on the revision of the federal constitution in Switzerland, the rise of the populist movement, and I know you've got some other ideas on how these two countries and documents have remained intertwined.
Thank you very much. I'm not sure I'm going to answer your question directly because it offers a smorgasbord of opportunities. I would like to accept warmly the invitation that I received here today. You might wonder why I'm here. I'm not Swiss. Two Swiss German people to my right. I represent the Swiss French, the Swiss Italian, the Swiss Romansh. And very importantly, I represent the guest workers, those who don't have citizenship in Switzerland, who are a full quarter of the population. The remarkable thing about these two sister republics is a certain level of interdependence, but very strong differentiation. In the hot, sweaty summer of 1787, the founding fathers of the United States made many fundamental errors. They drafted a constitution without a Bill of Rights. They had to have that amended. And very importantly, they drafted something which still plagues the United States today, an extremely badly designed electoral college for the election of a single person presidency along with a vice president. Fortunately, the Swiss were intelligent enough never to imitate this system. They do have a collective presidency. It's not called that by the Swiss. It's a federal executive council. It consists of seven members. If you are not a Swiss person, do not answer this question. If you are not a Swiss person, do not answer this question. Name me a Swiss politician. She named one. Most people don't know any Swiss politicians. That is a supreme virtue of the Swiss system. Seven presidents, they rotate in power. They only hold office for a year or sometimes less. Running the Federal Executive Council. That collective presidency, which expresses Swiss pluralism, is a dramatic success story. It's extremely difficult to export. The Swiss Federal Executive Council is not formed through a proportional representation election system, though all elections in Switzerland are conducted through some variation on proportional representation. Instead, the two Swiss chambers meet jointly with the Senate drowned out in terms of support because it's a smaller body, and they elect each of the seven members by majority vote. And the reason why they can produce such a pluralist outcome is that the four parties agree, roughly speaking, to follow a magic formula. And that magic formula is fascinating. Usually it leads to four Protestants and three Catholics, or four Protestants, two Catholics, and a Jew. Sometimes atheist members of those categories, like a Catholic atheist or a Jewish atheist. So there's no exclusion on religious grounds, reflecting past Swiss historic divisions. Normally, there are four German speakers, two French speakers, or three French speakers, one Italian speaker. So far, I think no Romansh speaker. So languages get represented in the formula. Parties get represented in the formula. Three get two seats each, one gets one seat. Nowadays, there's also a serious effort on gender grounds, four men, three women. It has varied over time. Switzerland is extraordinary in that it's one of the very few European countries, it may be the only European country, to have had a Jew in the Federal Executive Council, the most prominent executive body. So it's very inclusive, and it operates according to an informal agreement between the parties. Trying to export that anywhere else would be extraordinarily difficult. So what the Swiss do is sometimes have those two chambers, which are co-equal, meet collectively to make joint decisions. Nothing really parallel to that occurs in the United States. And that's an example of how the Swiss learned not to do things the American way. Now, the Swiss didn't learn to be nice to one another immediately. I don't want to give some impression of American folly and Swiss wisdom. After the Swiss Civil War, one party held the Federal Executive Council, I think until the early 1890s. And it's only after the 1890s that you get the gradual inclusion of the losers in the Civil War. So both countries were very slow at incorporating their losers successfully. We all know, of course, something about the history of Reconstruction in the United States, a disastrous failure. So neither country was totally wise in its response to civil war. There is, however, as emphasized by the ambassador in the beginning, a supreme virtue to the Swiss system, the relative ease of amendment. To amend the Swiss constitution, you require a popular majority and a majority of the cantons. By contrast, the founding fathers, in their wisdom, created a constitution which is extraordinarily difficult to amend. So how is the American constitution amended? Broadly speaking, by civil war or by coups in the Supreme Court. Occasionally, you get a really stupid amendment like banning alcohol, which is then repudiated. By the way, banning alcohol is a product of giving women the vote. The only negative consequence of giving women the vote. So they vary in that respect, and the Swiss system is therefore more adaptable and more sensitive. And you've heard already a remarkable feature of the Swiss system. In drafting laws, all the Swiss decision makers draft in the knowledge that there could be a referendum to overturn their law. That means they consult extensively in advance before drafting the legislation. They take great care to make the relevant legislation referendum proof. And that produces a much more consensual body of decision making, despite the fact that they have ideological differences inside the Federal Executive Council, people ranging from the socialist left to the conservative right. I'll stop there for now, but I would like to emphasize one major difference between the two countries. The Swiss have a long record of neutrality. And that record of neutrality is partly a result of their neighborhood. It's partly a result of their successful accomplishment of independence, which they accomplished through their own military power. That produces a remarkable level of citizen mobilization. You have every citizen, every male citizen, I think, is still required to perform military service or the equivalent. So the Swiss all have military equipment in their homes. In principle, the Swiss should kill one another at American rates, but they don't. Why not? Is it because of constitutional differences? No, I would say. The Swiss, until the last two or three decades, were one of the least mobile people on earth. Now, low mobility means great deal of local knowledge about everybody. Everybody's under constant surveillance. It's easy to have an affair in the United States. It's impossible to have an affair in Switzerland because everybody knows everybody and what you're doing. So the level of social surveillance in Switzerland, in my view, reduces Swiss crime. By comparison, America is a very, not only heterogeneous, but you've high levels of geographic and indeed social mobility, and that produces a very different public culture and opportunities for crime. I think I'll stop there for the moment.
I know we all have a few follow-up questions, but they're way off topic, so we'll have to take those at another time. Fabien, you're a political correspondent in the U.S. representing a Swiss media organization. From your perspective, can you dive a little bit deeper, more specifically, into some of the differences between politics and elections and how those play out between the United States versus Switzerland?
Well, we see that the electoral system clearly influences the political culture and how politics are carried out. I think Brendan mentioned now that the direct democracy forces the politicians to seek consensus, to find out who will be against passing a law, who will seek the votes to get a referendum, and try to avoid that. But the second element is the electoral system. While in the U.S., most politicians or all politicians are elected by majority vote.
Not a majority vote.
Say again?
It's not a majority vote. It's winner takes all.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry.
Very primitive.
Yep.
Everything's
yep.
American.
Yep.
This is democracy 101. No?
I'm sorry about that. It's been a while since my studies. In Switzerland, we have a lot of the politicians being elected in a proportional vote in the National Council, some states, even the Senate. And that makes for a very fragmented party landscape. It forces to seek constant majority coalitions, which are ever-changing because the society is fragmented along different dimensions in Switzerland. So it fragments the power. Nobody can really have a nationally viable large concentration of power in two parties, in two factions, like we see that in the United States. And there is a debate of how much of that is institutional, how much of that is caused by these electoral system, and how much of that is cultural, also part of the social control, which forces politicians to be more consensual and less provocative. So, whereas in a large heterogeneous country like the United States, that is much more difficult to achieve.
So when we think about voting and elections, it obviously affects the people. Tina, can we build on that and ask a very basic question? What makes someone Swiss?
Well, that's a good question. I do think some of the values that were mentioned earlier, like consensus building, multiculturalism. Also, we haven't really talked about the language and localism. Switzerland is a very local place. Brendan mentioned that people do not really move, and that's true, at least in my family. Like, everybody's married to someone they grew up with, kind of situation.
And the tyranny of the cousins.
Yeah, pretty much. And I do think this is one of the things that makes Switzerland unique, like this focus on local culture. I don't know, those of you who speak Swiss German, you can go online and you can put in, you know, words like at the core of an apple or the end of a loaf of bread, what you call that, and it can pinpoint you within the range of 20 miles or 20 kilometers of where you are from. And it was perfectly accurate for me, at least. I grew up on the lake of Zurich. I also think this focus on citizens, democracy. Like, my mom was the mayor of the town I grew up in, and so, like, you know, really you know, down to earth. Everybody, like, still to this day, you can't go grocery shopping with her without everybody knowing her. So I think the sort of, you know, people know each other, the, you know, localization, consensus, importance of the people, truly democratic system is certainly a part of that. There is some downside, and I agree with Brandon with this, you know, what did you call it? Surveillance? Yes. I do find the culture quite narrow, like what's acceptable. I always, like, people say, tell me, well, you know, how would you describe it? And I say, well, what's acceptable in Switzerland, if you're an insider, right? It's like maybe this big, and in the US, it's much, much bigger, right? Because you have to adjust. I mean, this isn't true necessarily for expats. I also think there's this myth, at least in the US, it's one of the questions I get a lot, that Switzerland is a very progressive country. And I wouldn't necessarily agree with that if we think about same-sex marriage, which just came to pass, or if we think about working women, like I'm a full-time working mom in the U.S., and that was something that was always accepted. I know had I been in Switzerland, that wouldn't have been the case. Like I look at my sister, who all my family, direct blood relations are in Switzerland. So if I compare my situation to hers, like that just wouldn't have been acceptable. With also her husband working full time. Also, I mean, women's rights is actually a good example. Most Americans are shocked if I tell them that the national women's right to vote was 1971, one of the last ones, and that there were cantons that we, you know, the Swiss Supreme Court had to say, yes, you have to give women the right to vote. So I would say Swissness is really, you know, Swiss culture is very local, is very inclusive, as, you know, we really, I think, minority rights, looking to distinguish ourselves, like flourishing dialects and cultural values. There's lots of advantages to this. Also, again, with regards to democracy, with regards to the constitution, but there are some downsides, again, with surveillance, maybe rigidity a little bit, if I may say so myself. Then, yeah, that's how I would answer it.
Brendan, we're talking a bit about culture and people, and that certainly is influenced by governing documents like the Constitution and the culture that formed those and how they've grown and changed, particularly as in Switzerland, it can grow and change. And inherently in any government, there's challenges with being inclusive, and people are always excluded, whether by intention or accident or lack of sophistication or what have you. Can you tell us a little bit about, from your perspective, who gets excluded in the United States and in Switzerland as a result of some of these structures?
A very good question, Lauren. If I may, I'd like to comment on something and supplement something that Fabian said, which I think is important for thinking comparatively. Switzerland uses proportional representation to elect its two major federal chambers. But the consequence is, precisely because there are multiple parties, any government that is formed, the federal executive, which I described earlier, and any legislation that is passed, genuinely rests on a popular majority. By contrast, the US voting system, which is a primitive voting system adopted from the United Kingdom, ex-voting for a peasant. I mean, the idea that you could rank things in numbers is considered extraordinarily complex and difficult. Produces, because of the combination of primaries and the two-party duopoly, which inhibits the formation of other parties, means that whoever is elected successfully, the Democrats or the Republicans, in either state or at the federal level, doesn't actually represent a popular majority in many, many cases. So a so-called majority system doesn't deliver majority government most of the time in the United States, which partly accounts for the levels of discord in the United States. Get rid of your British institutions. One of them is winner takes all in single member districts, wrongly called first past the post. Why is it wrongly called first past the post? because there is no post. It's not fixed. It implies that the system is fair because the horse that goes past the post first is the winner. But if the post isn't fixed, it's not clear who's going to win. If there are multiple candidates, like in a primary, you can win a primary with 4% of the vote if everybody else has 3% and become the candidate. Likewise at the state level. So that's a very important difference between the two countries. Proportional representation actually leads to majority support for the executive and for legislative decision making. Now that's before I answer your question. The key people excluded in Switzerland are the people who were not part of the original bargain, not part of the original cantons. So in Switzerland, there's a very large population, up to one quarter of the population, who are non-Swiss citizens, who are permanent residents. Not all of those people, of course, are permanent residents, but a high proportion become permanent residents. They enjoy very significant civil rights, but not the right to vote. Why? Because citizenship in Switzerland historically doesn't come via the federal government. It doesn't even come from the canton. It comes from the commune inside the canton. So that often meant, you know, 10,000 assembled males deciding whether or not they liked your face or not in public, not in private through some bureaucratic process. So these historically rich republican male forms of democracy led to forms of citizenship which today look redundant and exclusionary. And I don't want to imply that the Swiss model is stuck in that historic pattern. But that pattern has produced a difficulty of absorbing the guest worker population. And why is it particularly difficult? Well, you have three language groups, big ones, and then the Romansh. I believe the Romansh is mutually intelligible with Portuguese. Some people tell me that. There are significant numbers of marriages between Portuguese men and Romansh women. So they must speak in something to make that work. So if you're going to have immigrant streams into a multilingual polity, it's deeply destabilizing if they're going to upset the linguistic balance. So that's one of the reasons, I think, the hidden reason why it's difficult for Switzerland to convert large numbers of its permanent residents into citizens. What language group are they going to be part of? Which religious grouping, even if they don't believe, are they going to belong to? That's Switzerland's fundamental problem of integration. In the United States, and of course, Tina correctly emphasized the historic exclusion of women, partly emanating from a very male model of democracy. It was, after all, Swiss military units which were successful in liberating Switzerland, and there was a form of martial democracy in almost like the classical republics of the ancient world. In the United States, in the constitution made in a sweaty summer in 1787, everyone knows there was a sordid compromise. The United States was a sordid compromise based on free states making alignments with slave states. That's reflected in the three-fifths compromise, that an unfree person would count for three-fifths of a vote. That was in order to give the southern states sufficient influence in the Senate and in the House to form a blocking veto. And that system basically survived until the Civil War. So the United States was formed on the acceptance and deliberate exclusion of a very large section of the population. Not everybody wanted that to happen. There was a scheduled end to slavery built into the Constitution, and as we know, that didn't happen. So slaves were excluded from the beginning. In addition, the Native Americans were called and recognized as Indian nations. Interestingly, the federal government was given exclusive responsibility for relations with the Indian nations. And that's why, to this day, reservations are distinct from the states. The states can't interfere constitutionally in the reservations. Only the federal government can do that. That has sometimes led to a benign paternalistic relationship between the federal government and Native Americans. Much more often, the relationship has been exclusionary. As we know, under Andrew Jackson. There was mass expulsion of Native Americans. And that process of expulsion, exclusion, coercive assimilation, the process of destruction of Native American life has arguably continued to the present day. The United States was very fortunate in one respect. Its multiple Protestants hated one another. And because they hated one another, they agreed on rules of toleration that no one among them would be able to form an established church. And with some reluctance, they then had to apply that to other religions that came into the country, particularly Catholics, but also Jews, and more recently, those of other faiths. So the United States has had an accidentally fortunate route towards religious tolerance. And that marks it off as distinctive. Switzerland, of course, was once the epicenter of the most intolerant Protestant regimes. Calvin's Geneva was pretty close to one of Foucault's prisons. But nevertheless, Switzerland today is a much different country to the one that Calvin might have built if he'd been allowed to determine his legacy. I've gone on a long time. I'll shut up.
Fabian, you in a way are a political and cultural translator in your role as a journalist. What might you add to our commentary from Tina and Brendan about who is excluded and what makes someone Swiss? What do you feel like you need to translate back to people at home as a reporter here?
I think one of the things that I have to translate back is how the United States think about immigrants and how Americans perceive of themselves as Americans and how Swiss perceive of themselves as Americans. I think Brendan has explained a bit how the citizenship question is decided, and that rests with the perception of what it is to be a Swiss citizen. And I think the Swiss have been a strong immigration country without living up to the reality of that and without adapting their thinking. And parts of that is exactly the competition between the linguistic groups and the distribution of power with all these new arriving people. And translating this immigration debate and the citizenship debate that is brewing here in the United States as well with the debate about people being born in the United States, getting the United States citizenship or not. Trump mentioned that he wants to abolish that. Translating that debate back to Switzerland, where we see that there's skepticism towards immigrants here, but still a very different perception of citizenship here, and translating that debate to the Swiss debate about immigration, that I find to be something very difficult.
Tina, I see you nodding. What's on your mind?
Well, I agree with that, right? This idea that the U.S. is a melting pot, which isn't entirely true, I would say, or at least that's not the, you know, like if you think about the power structures and so on. I also really wanted to comment on something that Brendan started earlier, which is the gun question. Because honestly, this is the question I get asked the most when people find out that I'm Swiss. I don't know. I know there's other Swiss here. Is that true for you all as well?
Certainly.
Yes. It's like sort of like, and you know, I talked to my dad earlier today, and he was like, that's such an odd thing. It's such a micro, small, tiny. But it's true for, I mean, I wish they would ask me about chocolate or the mountains or something like that. But I want to say, I know I mentioned that, you know, the right to bear arms or the Swiss thinkers were influential for the Second Amendment. That being said, it ends at militia, okay? Both constitutions mention the word militia. The Swiss constitution does not mention the right to bear arms, okay? And especially not outside of military service. And I think this is the great misunderstanding that the gun lobby in the United States often uses, right? They oversimplify, or honestly, they're flat out wrong in saying this. And in my home state of Alabama, I often have this discussion around, well, isn't Switzerland a good example of why we should have a lot of guns? And the answer is no. In the Swiss context, right, there's no such thing as a right to bear arms outside of military service, and the number of Swiss people having guns per capita is only so high because those guns are for every male. And I think you mentioned this earlier, in the Swiss Constitution, it says every male has to serve in the military. For women, it's voluntary. In the military, for every male has to serve in the military or do an equivalent of civil service, right? So the distribution of guns in the Swiss system is because of that. If you actually look at privately owned guns, in the U.S. it's five times higher. There's a organization called the Small Arms Survey, which is out of Geneva, that looked at these numbers. And in the U.S., it's 1.2 per person, guns per person.
Including babies.
Yes, that includes babies. Like, that's among the population. Like, that's so obviously there's some people that have a lot of guns. Switzerland doesn't even make the top 10. It's about 2 million guns estimated on about 8.7 million people. So that's maybe 1 in 4 if you think about this. The other thing that's interesting is obviously the murder rates or gun-related death rates. And our again, the U.S. is way above everyone else. It's about, and I just looked this up, 12 per 100,000 people in 2019. In Switzerland, it's 2.8 per 100,000 people, which is very similar to countries like Canada. It is higher, I must say, it is higher than in other parts of Europe, which is slightly less than 1 per 100,000 people. But some of this has to do with, which I would say also, with gun culture, right? I don't think you see people posing with their guns in pictures. In Switzerland, or I haven't seen, I don't know if you have, but
it's a minority movement.
Yes, that's a good way to put it. But this is quite common in the U.S., as you probably all know, especially in certain places. So I really think that in Switzerland, the guns are mostly used for two things. One is the protection of the country, and the other one is sports. Switzerland has a very active sports shooting community, including events for youth like the Knabenschießen, translated boys shooting in Zurich, which this was actually the only and first time I ever shot a gun, and it was more of a women's rights thing because in 1991 they started allowing girls. And I was a teenager at that time, so I'm dating myself here. And I went just to showcase that we could do it too. So, but I do think there's a great misunderstanding in this question of, well, Switzerland has guns per capita. They don't have a high murder rate or whatever, or gun-related death rate or injury rate. And there are structural reasons why that is.
Well, there is one subset of data where Switzerland does have a problem with the high prevalence of guns at suicides, exactly. Where we see that the presence of guns, the sheer presence of guns and their power of destruction just has catastrophic results. And we struggled with getting that under control. So yes, that is also one part where we see a negative consequence.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah.
Tina mentioned asking about the mountains and chocolate, perhaps watches. And of course, we should talk about banking briefly, as we're here on the topic of Switzerland. Brendan, in our prep call, you shared some perspective about Switzerland's identity and success and prowess within the international banking world, right? Can you talk a little bit about that, how that's tied into culture and government and why they're so successful today?
What I think I told you, Lauren, and you can correct me if I'm telling you mythological stories. I think what I'm about to tell you is not as mythological as William Tell. Why are the Swiss specialized in banking? Well, the answer is that the Swiss military were very successful in the late medieval, early modern period in defeating the Habsburgs and other neighboring powers, developed military capacity, and hired themselves out as mercenaries in the general neighborhood. Mercenaries like to be paid in cash. So the mercenary captains wanted some secure location for their loot. So they sent it back to Switzerland. And that's how Swiss banking developed, off mercenary activity. So the success of Swiss banking is directly owed to Swiss militarism. And I would say that there's a nice contrast here with the United States. The United States begins in deep suspicion of banking, particularly among the Jeffersonians, and that goes through to Andrew Jackson, who actually abolishes the central bank. Could I segue into explaining why Philadelphia lost its capital city status, just briefly, as a point of local civic resentment? Why is this country, why is this city not the capital of the United States? It was the biggest city. It was the place the Constitution was made. It's bang in the middle on the coastline. It should be the federal capital, right? Well, why did it lose its status? Well, on the only occasion before the Civil War where a northern state committed treachery to the rest of the north, a squalid deal was done between a northern state and the southern states. The southern states didn't want a big, strong capital like Philadelphia, particularly inhabited by those who weren't particularly in favor of slavery. In fact, if anything, Philadelphia became a site of strong emancipation movements. So the squalid deal was this: New York will get the bank and we'll build the federal capital in a swamp in Northern Virginia, so it can't be powerful. So it's that conjunction of forces in the early history of the American Republic that asset strips Philadelphia, both of the Congress and of the bank. There you are. You can correct me if I'm wrong, but that's my account of the story. So in the US, the Republicans, particularly the Jeffersonian Republicans, were deeply suspicious of banking. No such inhibition appears to have developed in early Swiss statehood. To the contrary, it was understood that banking was part of the underpinning economic success of whatever economic success Switzerland might have. And the later history of banking, I leave to others.
Fabian, when we think of... Oh, please.
Eventually, New York became the commercial center of the United yes. States. But the first bank of the United States was down the street.
Absolutely.
And the second bank yes. of the United
the
States.
The second is the architectural failure, right?
Yeah. Nonetheless, the fact of the matter remains is that you are quite right that Mr. Jefferson and Mr. Madison were very much opposed to a central bank. I had originally been opposed to a central bank, but when I saw the success of Alexander Hamilton, or Colonel Hamilton, fighting William Dewar, who had been his second in the Treasury, who attempted to corner the bond market, and that through Hamilton's creativity, let us put it simply that way, of moving money around from one to another bank in the Bank of the United States system, he defeated that effort to corner the market. So while Jefferson and Madison opposed a central bank, I did not. And in 1811, when it came up for rechartering, I also stood up to Mr. Madison and said, it needs to be rechartered. And I pointed out to him again when I returned in 1816 that the effort to charter a second bank of the United States needed to be successful. And so we should be a little careful of saying the Democrats, Republicans in general terms opposed it. Jefferson and Madison and others like them did. However, it was not universal. And there was an understanding that there was, in fact, a better way of doing business, and that a central bank acted as to use a Swiss image, was a balance wheel for the economy.
Thank you very much, sir. And you're looking wonderful for 280 years.
It's the ice I sit in.
I was going to say, you're more of an expert than I am on that. However, I did also read, I thought at one point, there was also a deal Jefferson to get his vote vis-a-vis the banking area. George Washington, I think, recommended to Hamilton about compromise. And I thought part of the deal was Jefferson didn't want to have to go to Philadelphia or New York, ultimately, for the capital. He wanted to go to D.C. because it was closer to where he was in Virginia. So I don't know what your thoughts were on that, but there was kind of, I think, that aspect as well. But it's well said that.
Sordid personal matters, not just an inter-party deal. Yes, quite possible.
Personal motivations always play a role in big political decisions. Staying with the banking theme for a minute in present-day Switzerland, Fabian, can we ask you to comment on how Switzerland strengthened the banking, international banking community in particular, have affected its role and the requests put upon it as a result of the war in Ukraine and Russia?
Well, yeah, I mean, the financial system is getting Switzerland into trouble, clearly. I mean, I'm afraid to say so. Switzerland, after having developed that banking system, developed a strong international reputation for that also, notably during World War II, when everybody in Europe was trying to get their wealth away from the Nazis. And that got Switzerland into trouble in the 90s because the banks weren't giving back the money to the people that it belonged to, and we had the tax evasion scandals following soon after that, which were all due to these banking secrecy laws. Now, in the meantime, Switzerland has established a lot of transparency in the financial market, has done many reforms for international compliance, but as we now see with the war in Ukraine and the quest for Russian wealth distributed and hidden all over Europe and the world, we see that Switzerland has a lot of Russian assets still in Switzerland, and there are loopholes in the legislation, particularly concerning anti-money laundering, that raise suspicion with our international partners, particularly that lawyers are not yet fully subject to anti-money laundering dispositions, particularly concerning shell companies and housing market. And the Swiss have promised to make better on that, but there's a lot of pressure being put on it. There's a suspicion that there's more Russian assets hidden in Switzerland that Switzerland is admitting. And we'll see where that regulation goes. And with regard to the pressure, Switzerland defends its laws and processes and says that the court system and the judicial system is just following its work. But some international partners like the United States don't fully trust the Swiss, and that is due to some lack of political zeal that we've seen when Switzerland was taking position after the Russian attack on Ukraine. It was for a long time, it was not clear on whether Switzerland would remain neutral or in what way Switzerland would remain neutral. And I think that has raised all suspicions again.
Tina, I see you nodding. Anything to add here?
Yeah, I do think the, you know, sort of this question of what role has Swiss banking played, you know, during World War II with Jewish money. I remember, like, that was the time when I was in graduate school and I worked on some of those documents of the Berger Commission, and like the unwillingness to kind of have that debate in the Swiss public, or at least that's how I perceived it at the time. And I think that continues, and in my mind, that's problematic because, I mean, if you look at Swiss history for a very long time, Switzerland was a very poor country. And it is partially because of the rise in banking and sort of different gray powers needing a safe place where money could be, again, hidden away, at least to a certain extent. And I appreciate that, you know, a lot of this has been now, or they have started to address the issues that come with that, right? But I think there probably needs to be more discussion in the public about, you know, what, you know, like, I don't know, I think there seems to be a willingness to sort of see, well, Switzerland was neutral in World War I, it was neutral in World War II, it's you know, everything's good, it's beautiful, and the system works, right, the political system works, and an unwillingness to kind of reckon with some of the injustices that have happened.
Let's take some questions from the audience. Is anyone with us here today that has a question for our panelists? Yes. I believe there's a microphone heading your way. Thank you.
So I'm a Swiss. I'm a French-speaking Swiss. So I'm, again, a minority here today. We're Christian, I know we both speak French. But so I wanted to say something about what Tina, excuse me, I don't remember your family name, said about women in Switzerland. So I'm a former politician. I mean, I was a politician in Switzerland. So I was very much interested by all these topics. You see, for example, your family probably, from what I hear, comes from the Swiss-German side. There's a major difference between the Swiss-French side and the Swiss-German side. So, for example, I was very much involved in childcare in Geneva. And I'd say that women wanted to work part-time. And it was not like to shame women who were working full-time at all. It was just because they wanted to have sort of an equilibrium between the professional life and the family life. And I find that here in America, it's very difficult to have that. Yeah. And so that's one major difference I see. And I regret because, you know, it's a shame. I mean, people don't have a choice. I understand that it has to do with the culture. I mean, people accept that if you try to find a job, you'll be asked to work 100%. In my culture, this is not something I want. This is not something I'm used to. So that's just a small difference. You also mentioned some differences. For example, I sort of feel that in Switzerland, we have more like a long-term thinking, I mean, around the environment, around all sorts of topics. But like that's a major difference between here and there, is this sort of long-term thinking, whereas here it's more short-term thinking based on how much money you can make. So, I'm not going to go too much into these types of deep details, but I just wanted to mention that, and that was not mentioned much today, but in Switzerland, we have minorities. I'm among these minorities. I'm I think 20% of Swiss French, 10% of Swiss Italians, 25,000 Romansh, and then the rest is Swiss German. But we nevertheless find, and that's a very important topic, is we find a consensus and we want to work around consensus. Mm-hmm. And I think that's great. And I wish that it was more the case here in America. And I'll stop here.
Yes, no, I appreciate that you brought this up. There's definitely differences between the different parts of Switzerland. And I do appreciate your... It's true that you have the choice to work part-time, right? As a woman in here, it's much less so. And I think some of this is structural. In Switzerland, health insurance is not connected with your job or is not provided through your employer. And so you're much less, like often these benefits in the US are only given if you work full-time. So there's a pressure to work full-time, and that's not the case in Switzerland. So you're absolutely correct, and I appreciate that input that in Switzerland, women have more choice. I just, from the discussions, and I follow them somewhat closely on, you know, social media and other outlets, and I'm oversimplifying here, or I'm overstating, okay? But you're a bad mother if you don't work, because then you don't expose your children to a, women can do the same thing, or, you know, you shouldn't just be at home, that's not enough. But if you work too much, then you're a bad mother, because why do you even have children? Like, I've been asked this, why do you have children if you work full time? I don't know if many men have been asked this here, so I've been asked, not in the U.S. context, but in Switzerland. So that's, you know, like how, as a Swiss mother, if you work between 40 and 60%, you're considered a good mother. I know I'm oversimplifying, okay?
No.
So I'm not oversimplifying. But if you work less than that, or if you work more than that, that's part of what, you know, like, yes, on the surface, it might seem that you have a choice, but underneath, it might not be as strong. So that's the part of the narrowness that I mentioned with cultural Swissness that sometimes comes. That it's maybe always something I've kind of rebelled against, even when I was there. So
I guess the social norms are narrower and more strict. That's part of the surveillance that Brendan was talking about.
Clearly, you're a bit of a rebel since you ended up in Alabama from Switzerland, charting your own course in life. We've got another question in the back here.
May I?
Yes, please.
Thank you. First of all, congratulations. I am from Argentina, at the other end of the world, of these Americas, and I want to emphasize the influence of Swiss people in our origins. Swiss people are very famous because they brought us music. They were teachers of music at elementary schools in Argentina. I don't know if you knew it, but they did a lot for our culture. From the second city of Argentina. It's called Rosario. And also, one other aspect is Swiss shooting. In all small places of this corn area I live in, there are Swiss shooting buildings still frequented by Argentinians. Argentina is a melting pot, and I want to thank you the contribution you did for our culture.
Thank you. I see some more hands up. There's a microphone coming around to you shortly.
My name is Ryan Ellis. I had the privilege of living in Ticino for 4 years, and I miss it every day, so we'll just say Fort Sombri. My question is that we spoke a lot today about the influence of the U.S. Constitution on the Swiss Constitution. I'm just curious, however, when the southern states are breaking or attempted to break away from the United States, the strong states' rights, the strong confederation in Switzerland, was there much influence or any evidence of much influence from the Swiss Constitution on the breakaway states during before the Civil War?
I don't think so. I think the Confederate arguments were either based on Calhoun's claim, which is a very powerful claim, that the Constitution merely was a set of amendments of the Articles of Confederation. So Calhoun argued the Articles of Confederation are still in force. The Northerners are breaking the contract, therefore we can secede because each state retains sovereignty. And when they create the Confederation of the United States, the Confederation of States of America, their draft constitution is a version of the Articles of Confederation, but modernized, influenced by the 1787 Constitution. So their thinking is very American-centric rather than influenced by the Swiss case. And if they thought about the Swiss case, of course, the Swiss federal centralizers had already won their civil war by that time, so it would not have functioned as a good example for the Southern Confederacy.
Thank you.
I'd like to come back to the lady. The Swiss housewife, if she raises 4 kids, that's a full-time job. Does she get a retirement?
Like money, you mean?
Yeah.
No. It's unpaid work, basically, yeah.
Slavery.
Yeah.
Can I just say something?
Yeah.
Except that there is a compensation for the years you spend with your kids, for mm-hmm. example. Like, yeah. And even in the case of a divorce, that's very important.
Yeah.
Meaning that the, what we call first pillar in Switzerland, which is the social security here, is divided between the husband and the wife. So it's true that it's not perfect, but at least there is that.
Okay.
Yeah.
A question, and are there other models of governing a country? Because I read the book in Singapore from the former ruler, and he said, I want to run the country like a business. So he has an executive suite of people. He said, politicians are not able to run the country. I need executives to run the country, and they're going to pay them the average salary of a top CEO, and they're going to get bonuses if the population are happy. Are these new models countries are considering or not?
I don't know of anywhere where they're being considered outside of that Singaporean rhetoric, which is deeply unconvincing coming from the hereditary ruler of the first post-colonial prime minister. The interesting thing about Lee Hwan Kyu, have I pronounced his name correctly? He was influenced deeply by Jeremy Bentham. So he restructured Singapore on very strict utilitarian lines. So one of the reasons why Singapore became so dramatically clean was he applied Bentham's principle. Extremely high penalties for small, irritating nuisances that you want to get rid of. So that's why it's a $1,000 fine if you don't flush a public toilet. It's a $1,000 fine if you put chewing gum in the underground. All of which leads to a cleaner and better running train system. There's no evidence that businessmen make better politicians generally, including businessmen who are probably shortly to be found to be running corrupt organizations. So the idea that that works is unpopular. What I do think is interesting is the question of whether we should go back to some ancient thinking. And in the thinking of the ancients, the idea was that you would pay the politicians well to keep them free of corruption. The problem, I think, in the current age is we've allowed inequality of extraordinary proportions. So the average politician who comes from an average background is totally dwarfed in wealth by the leader of a major corporation. And the ability to bribe, either personally or through party funding, has become extensive. And that's what we need to think about. And I would also want to argue for high pay for those in public civil service positions to keep them free of corruption, and indeed to ban them from joining private organizations for a very long interval, having been in office. So the things we can do across a lot of democracies to organize better relations between government and business. And because we're also contemptuous of politicians, we're inclined not to pay them properly. And that's a mistake.
Good morning, good afternoon. Thank you all for a very interesting presentation so far. This has been very enlightening. I want to ask a simple question that probably has a very complicated answer. Conversations so far have been mostly about the executive and the legislative branches of the two governments, and I wonder if we could open a comparative discussion on the role of the judiciary. Here in America, the headlines are constantly filled with stories about what the Supreme Court has done or is about to do and who the next nominee will be and all these sorts of things. I do follow some headlines in Switzerland. I don't see very many headlines that involve the judiciary in Switzerland, so I wonder if you could comment on why we find ourselves with the situation we have and why Switzerland does not have that situation.
If I'm correct, and I'll have my Swiss colleagues correct me if I'm wrong, the Swiss Constitution does not empower Switzerland's highest court with the right of striking down a statute passed by the Swiss two chambers of parliament on grounds of non-compliance with the Constitution. They may be able to point out that there's a disparity, but they can't strike down the legislation. And in effect, the Swiss leave it to referendum to deal with any problematic legislation. So if you pass something controversial, you face the possibility of having a referendum to overturn it. So I think it's a deeply different culture. There is full rule of law in Switzerland. There's a full professional judiciary. And there isn't a level of politicization of judicial appointments that we see in the United States. Now, everybody who does their high school civics class in the United States learns that John Marshall gave the US Supreme Court the right to strike down statutes. It clearly has the power of interpretation in the Constitution. It's ambiguous whether they ever had the right to strike down statutes. So I think one of the reasons why the Supreme Court is of such centrality in the United States is precisely because the Constitution is so difficult to amend. If the Constitution was much easier to amend, then the Supreme Court would be much less tempted to intervene. and appointing people to the Supreme Court would become less important than it might otherwise be. Those are the cultural contrasts I would draw. And in fact, you could even say that the democratic heart of Switzerland is evident in the sense that the idea that justices would decide what the law is, as opposed to interpret and apply it, is considered something close to an outrage.
Yeah, and I mean, just to add to this, in Switzerland, the Supreme Court, these are not lifetime appointments. They're elected for, I think, 6 years or 9 years. Correct me if I'm wrong. I think, or eight. Like some the relics. I'd have to look this up. I'm sorry, I didn't do that ahead of time. But like, it's a relatively short period of time. And probably if you go around and ask Swiss citizens if they can name a member of the Swiss Supreme Court, I don't think. You know, so the stature, in addition to that, is much less, right? Because people are voted onto the Supreme Court, and they can also be voted off the Supreme Court. So it's not a lifetime appointment.
Fabienne, I see you nodding. Thoughts to add to this?
Yeah, exactly. I was just thinking about controversial Supreme Court decisions, and just none come to mind. I think, I guess, the most controversial issues have been around asylum processes and granting asylum. That's some political debate, but the rest is, as Brendan said, up to the political bodies to decide, not to the judicial body, according to Swiss tradition. Yeah.
So Switzerland proves that you can have a functioning federal democracy without empowering a Supreme Court in the manner that the U.S. does.
Could I ask a very quick follow-up? And that is, did the Swiss learn something from the example of John Marshall and what he did by establishing the precedent of the Supreme Court striking down legislation? He did that many years prior to 1848. Was there any thinking involved in setting up the judiciary?
I can't tell you. I don't know. It's a good question.
I have one final question for our panelists before we conclude and move to the reception. Do you believe we can still call the United States of America and Switzerland sister republics? Fabienne, I'll start with you.
Well, I think we've seen so many differences now in this discussion that it's really hard. I mean, to call them still sister republics. They've taken dramatically different directions, different flavors of federalism, of republicanism. The political cultures today are worlds apart, even if some Swiss try to imitate Tucker Carlson without that much success, though. But may I add, just geopolitically, I would say that yes, we can still call the United States and Switzerland sister republics, particularly from the Swiss point of view. The United States is an incredibly important partner for Switzerland, not only economically, but politically. Switzerland is a country that can't decide whether it wants to be part of the European Union or not, and is having a hard time maintaining a working relationship with a big neighbor. So a large power, economic powerhouse outside is completely something the Swiss want. And we have seen in the last 10 years that economically, scientifically, cooperation has improved, has gone up. The United States are now the biggest trading partner of Switzerland. So the strategic value for the Swiss of this sister republic is can't be measured. And from the side of the United States, I would say, obviously, they're not that dependent on Switzerland, but they're interested in keeping a close eye on an important trading place for financial market products, for commodities. I think the Ukraine war has shown exactly that. And while the Switzerland is seen clearly as part of the Western alliance by the United States, even if there is some friction and there are some questions. So yeah, I would hesitatively say that geopolitically, yes, still sister republics.
Tina, your thoughts?
Just to add to what Fabienne said, I think in terms of values, right? Like democracy, general, human rights, Western values that came out of the era of enlightenment. In that sense, yes. I think in terms of the way they developed, much maybe less so. I don't know if you saw that a bunch of presidential libraries and or foundations just came out with a statement being really worried about American democracy. That was yesterday. I think the only one that wasn't participating was the Eisenhower Foundation, but 13 or I forget exactly how many actually supported this. And I am not worried about the democracy in Switzerland. I think the models that have worked, as Brendan said, for, you know, centuries, the focus on the local empowering communes and municipalities and so on, that's still going very strong, obviously with some modifications, and I'm not saying we're there, but in terms of value, democracy, lived democracy today, I think the U.S. has gone down a very difficult and honestly troubling path.
I agree fundamentally with most things my colleagues have said. I would say the relationship is between first cousins once removed, not sisters, if we must use the analogy. And I'd say once removed because, as Fabian correctly emphasized, Switzerland has a problem about the European Union. And I'd like to briefly discourse on that. The Swiss voted against joining the European Economic Area because of the double majority requirement. A majority of the public must agree and a majority of the cantons. And a majority among the cantons was not generated. You might say, speaking in metaphors, that Heidi is against joining the European Union, meaning the German-Swiss in the mountains, the countryside. That's a deep division. And it's got some analogies with US divisions. If we think of the division between cosmopolitan liberal orientations and provincial orientations, that's present in both polities and animates both of them. Because of Swiss institutions, it generates an absurd set of relationships. Switzerland has something like 120, I lose count, treaties with the European Union. Each time the EU changes something significant, Switzerland usually has to have a treaty passed by its public to stay in line with the European Union. Absurdly, some people among les Anglais, about whom we will not ridicule much today, wanted the Swiss model with the European Union, you know, constantly updating their treaties with referendums. Obviously a model that would never work. The European Union looked at discussion of Swiss EU relations and said to the UK, you can have any model you like, but it won't be the one that we have with Switzerland. Right? That's not a viable model. So what I'd emphasize is the European distinctiveness and almost eccentricity of the Swiss model, with the citizens through treaties having a very important veto over foreign policy relationships, including foreign policy relationships affecting trade. Imagine what the United States would be like if trade agreements were subject to referendums. No? First cousins once removed.
Please join me in thanking our panel of experts today.